Hey, welcome to the commentary track for Two Kates. This is Zach Schultz. I wrote and directed Two Kates. And this is the first episode, which we shot second. We shot the second episode first and the first episode second. We shot all these episodes kind of out of order for various complicated reasons. But this is the first episode, so I'll be talking about that. It starts with this really long shot where Kate has to do a change off camera, which I can walk you through that. So Kate is here, then
Kate.
Laura enters.
Oh, thanks. Yeah, I'm doing really well. It's so good to see you.
And then as soon as Kate leaves screen here,
thanks.
Now Kate is running around the apartment to get back to the kitchen and so she can change before we get back. And Laura is actually now talking to Sophie Buttigan, who is recording sound for us this day. And Sophie is doing Kate's lines with Laura, and then we had Kate come in later and dub the lines back over so that it sounds like they're talking. But actually, in reality right now, Laura is talking to Sophie while Kate is in the kitchen frantically trying to change sweaters and put this apron on, which she managed to do pretty well here.
Hey, Laura.
Which is a kind of complicated shot. We're shooting it as the sun was going down, which was sort of one extra layer of complication to it that maybe wasn't necessary, but seemed artistically necessary at the time. Anyway, it took some work, but we got it. So this scene was pretty fun to shoot. I really like Kate and Laura's performance in it. I feel like Kate doesn't get the chance really in the series to act very confident in scenes. This is kind of maybe the only scene in the whole show where she actually seems more self-confident, or at least compared to Laura, that she's the confident one currently. And so it's kind of funny to see it now after having finished the whole series to see her actually be confident and not just be full of anxiety, although that comes later. I guess you have to start somewhere to show someone's descent. Yeah, I guess because that was part of the concept is that when the show starts, they're both very excited about it, the two Kate clones, because it feels like it's the solution to this problem. But then over the course of the series, the problem kind of starts coming back. So this episode's maybe strange relative to the other ones because it doesn't really get into the kind of internal struggle in the Kate character that kind of is what the rest of the series is about.
Barbecue chicken salad.
Kate is really good at fake laughing, we learned shooting this episode, which came in handy because she had to do that a lot. She had to make it seem like she was just naturally tickled at what she was doing, even on the, you know, many takes into the night. So I appreciate her skill in being able to conjure that up. It's harder than it looks. Laura and I made a movie together a while ago called Arctic Sounds, which she was great in, so I was glad to be able to work with her again on this.
Oh,
this last shot, let's talk about that. This is the very last shot that's coming up. This is pretty complicated, where the Kates start clapping at each other. So when it starts here, Kate and Abbott is really sitting on the couch, so Laura is actually wearing Kate's sweater and walking past the camera to pretend to create the effect that Kate is walking in front of the camera. And so, but then we filmed it, you know, twice. So we had the camera stay in place and had the Kate who's closest to us do her side. And then we had the Kate who's farthest from us do her side second. And we timed it so that they would start clapping at the same time. And it's pretty complicated. The S-A-T-U-R-D-A-Y thing is, in my mind, it's either a reference to So I Married an Ex-Murderer or a Mr. Peanut commercial. Two things from my childhood that probably would pop in my head if there were two of me and I had to chant something with that person. So it's seems accurate to what I predict my experiences would be. Oh, and this is the first time that we get to use a Surf Curse song in this show, which they're great. And it kind of became the sound of the show as it went along. So So for scheduling reasons, this was actually the first episode that we shot. And the scene that you're watching right now is actually the very first full scene that we shot in the show. Also, this long shot of the two Kates playing guitar with each other, which Kate is, in a sense, actually playing live right now. We had the camera locked down, stationary, and so the Kate on the right, who's doing the rhythm guitar, we had Kate do that a bunch of times to work out the timing of it, basically. And so and we recorded the sound as she was doing it, and then we had her change clothes once she had done that and then go sit on the other couch on the left hand side of the screen and play the other guitar along with the recording we had made of her playing on the right hand side. So what you're actually seeing is actually let me think of how to put this. So you're actually seeing her play the song that we're hearing. It's not dubbed in later, or she's not playing along with a pre-recorded track. She is actually playing that guitar right now. So this schedule that you're about to see was written out by Sarah Spink, who did all the art for the show. And so that's kind of the first piece of art that you get to see of hers in the series. See a bunch of Sheltie stuff in the bedroom. This is my bedroom, minus the Sheltie stuff's not there when in there normally, although nothing against it. See, that's my sad lamp. Use that sometimes. So this scene, I guess, is kind of the introduction of the actual character of who this Kate character is when she's by herself. It's maybe the first time in the show that you get to kind of see her mindset or how her brain works a little bit. Prior to now, it's been sort of more surface kind of stuff or more fun stuff, but now you're kind of starting to see the day-to-day kind of mindset and some of the traps she might fall into. Kate's great in the scene. I did one kind of tricky thing in the editing of it. So when you hear the one Kate on the couch ranting, so now it's doing the slow zoom in on the one that's listening. Kate, as she was doing it, like any natural, as any, you know, real life person would, you know, she takes a breath because she, you know, she says a sentence and she has to pause while she takes a breath. So I edited out all of those times when she takes a breath so that it makes it this sort of run-on thing. So it's taking all those little spaces out to make it a little bit more unrelenting. Oh, one silly kind of thing that's coming up that if you pause it, you can notice is on this greeting card with the poodle on it here, that's a wedding invitation. Inviting you to the wedding of Jimmy Lee Jr. and Stephen Paul Smith, which originally it should be Jimmy Lee Lindsay Jr., but there was a typo in there. But anyway, but those are the real names of the musicians Jay Retard and Elliot Smith. So Two Kates takes place in a universe where Jay Retard and Elliot Smith are still alive and getting married to each other in Olympia, Washington. This dance was choreographed by Kate. She did that all on her own, which was great. So that song by the Prids is in that scene, which is great. I was really excited that when we got to use their song. Been a fan of theirs for a very long time now. Oh, this thing that Kate thinks that you see on the screen, this phrase, you're welcome to use that. This is the phrase that I had to come up with because I needed something to say when people come to the door and I wanted to brush them off in a friendly way. And it's a good way to do it if you are so inclined. You're welcome to steal it. I've gotten pretty good at saying it, even if the Kate character has some issues with it currently. Oh, and this is Hannah Grenfell. She's excellent. She plays the clipboard girl. And I like her in this. I like that she's not really villainous at all. I feel like that was an important part of it, that we didn't want it to seem like she's pushy because she has this job to do. She wants to get her signature, but there's nothing sort of malicious about it, that she's just essentially good at her job. But that pushes Kate to because she can't respond to it. But I feel like I like that that Hannah didn't. There was no mustache twirling or anything. She's not pushing it hard. She's just she just has a goal, and that goal happens to kind of conflict with Kate's mentality. And I like the look she gives as she walks away. And now we've got kind of the sad montage. It started out as the happy montage as we're seeing the schedule going before and they're actually doing the things on the schedule. And now it's the sad montage when the schedule it keeps going again. But now we see that they're missing the things that they should be doing. And, it's funny going into these things. I was thinking about, I've never sort of set up a shot thinking like, oh, this is a good idea, like from another movie, like take a thing, intentionally. But this sort of sequence of all these still shots with the words on the screen and sort of seeing them do their things, I realized after the fact is like stolen from the movie Rushmore. But that was not intentional. It's a loving homage because I'm a fan of that movie. This is one of my favorite scenes in the show where she makes this card. I like that you have this moment with her sort of, taking it seriously, or that you can, it creates this feeling like these cards mean something more to her than just silly dog cards. Although silly dog cards are fine also, but there's, I like that scene because where she's making the one while the other one's playing with the box. I like that scene because it's just it's a strange moment, and it's kind of it reminds me of things in my own life. That mug that she takes that toothbrush out of is a Boise School District mug, which you get if you're a teacher in the Boise School District for 5 years. I think for your 5-year anniversary they give you that mug. Although I bought that one in a Salvation Army in Boise, Idaho. So I was glad to be able to put it in the show. That's my school district growing up. This episode, I'm really proud of the music in this. I really love all these bands. This is the episode where music starts to become sort of more important to the show. It starts to get integrated more into the series as it goes along. And I really like that. I really love all these bands. You should check them out if you get a chance. So we shot the beginning of this episode in a safe way. In Portland here, tried to do it discreetly. It's just it's me and Kate and Sophie Bettigan, who did sound for us sometimes and sometimes did the off-screen stuff for Kate. She would kind of run interference, or she would sort of create a human barricade behind me. I would be holding a very small camera and pointing it at Kate while she shopped. And then Sophie would sort of provide coverage for me to kind of hide the camera. But basically, we're just running around the Safeway with the camera, trying not to get any other people in the shot, and film this scene. And then this is the parking garage of that same Safeway. We only had two crew people on the show. It was Sophie and then Regina Amadeo. And Sophie and Regina would sort of take turns either being the person, holding the boom mic, or they would be the person doing the lines for Kate off screen, since there's only one Kate in real life. So we'd have to have somebody else to play the second Kate as a stand-in for us to replace later. And so Sophie and Regina would kind of take turns doing those jobs. And oftentimes they would be doing two jobs at once. So they would be off screen with the lines for Kate, performing as the fake Kate, and while also holding a microphone for that Kate to talk into. And they did a great job. It's important that they were good, since there was only two of them, and they would kind of take turns. There would typically just be me doing the camera stuff and one of them to do sound and to do the off-camera stuff. Usually it would just be one of them at a time, just because of scheduling, just whoever could make it work at that time. Although there were sometimes when they could both do it, and those were those were one of the some of the easier days. Because yeah, we would do the show with a very small crew. I would do all the camera and lighting stuff while I was directing, and then I would need help with the sound because I only have the two arms. I like the work that Kate did in this episode as the clone that doesn't know what's going on, the one who's not running the game on the other one. I feel like her work as that clone, it's the exact right mix of kind of clueless but kind of suspicious, and I don't know, it really makes me laugh that the way she played it. I appreciate that. I like these birthday cards. They're made for us by Sarah Spink, like all the other artwork, and they really are pretty good. Between these two cards, it's funny, we put them next to each other, so there are two different cards that Sarah made that are like pretty much identical, and then it's funny though when I watch the two of them side by side, I actually do have a favorite one. I actually like one of them more than the others. Maybe there's something to be said for these Kate's craziness, or maybe there's something to be said about me being crazy. Of course, they're both great. This scene was hard to shoot because there were leaf blowers going on outside while we were shooting part of it. We started shooting the scene, and then my neighbors, a bunch of leaf blowers, came in to do the lawns of the apartments next door to me, and then we had to stop for a little while, and anyway, eventually cleared up, and we were able to finish it, but it was pretty tough. This was a pretty tight day for us because we were shooting all of the daytime stuff. Everything after breakfast we shot all in one day, so starting with them making cards to the rest of the episode, this was all one day of shooting. And it's all with the natural light in that room. I'm not bringing in other lights to shoot it. So it's sort of, that sets the time limit on how quickly we need to move before the lighting changes and things like that. That it stops looking natural after a while. The photo, those photos on the wall there of the Sheltie, those are Kate's that we put there. Kate. In real life, like the character Kate, has a great fondness for the Shetland sheepdog, which is where that comes from. The apartment that we shot in here as the Kate's apartment, this is actually the apartment where I live with my partner Sophie, who did a lot of the sound recording for the show. So I realized I should probably say that because I tend to refer to it as my apartment when... maybe don't know that, maybe just know it as the Kate's apartment, but anyway, that's where I live, and that's where I'm sitting right now as I record this. It was a proud moment for me writing this episode when I realized that the Kate who was being tested, as it were, that she would interpret that as the other Kate becoming better than her. Because I wrote it in chronologically. I was kind of making it up as it went along. I didn't have an outline or anything like that. I tend to just try and write one scene and have it be good and then push forward into the next scene. And so that moment of the one Kate realizing it was the same time that I realized that she would feel that way. And felt good. Made me want to give myself a high five. Because I'm so cool. This episode kind of serves the purpose of setting up that when I was conceiving of this, it was important to me that the two Kates were indistinguishable. So even though in the first episode she mentions that they'll probably grow apart, and this episode is kind of about them worrying about them growing apart, that to me the series was always about one person, you know, talking to herself, essentially. And so... this episode is kind of addressing the idea that that they might change, but then sort of establishing that no, they're still pretty much the same person. Because though you don't necessarily know it at this point in the series, if you're just watching it, that but for me that was always sort of the draw to me, that I always wanted it to be about just the one Kate essentially. And her sort of interacting with herself rather than two clones turning into two different people or something like that. Now here's episode 4. And that shot right there, that's Regina's hand shaking Kate in this shot. I kind of lucked out that both Regina and Sophie have kind of the same complexion as Kate, at least on their arms. so they could both double for Kate throughout the show. I could, anytime one of the Kates had to grab one of the other ones or hand something off or do anything like that, one of the hands is either Sophie's or Regina's. And this episode's kind of funny. It's weird. So from this point on, if you want to, you can tell which Kate is which in the story. So the one that talks to their mom on the phone is not the one who goes to the meeting, because in the scene they describe that deal. And then so essentially you can track the two different Kates from now until the end of the montage in episode 7. So at episode 7, then when they go to Yellowstone, then you can't tell them apart anymore. But up until then, it is technically possible to follow them individually, although it's not that important if you get confused, I feel like. This episode's also sort of the turning point, I guess, in the series, where it starts out maybe more comedic, and then as it goes along, it gets more serious, and maybe there's more of the drama side starts taking over. So this is kind of the turning point, maybe, where it starts to lean more on the drama side, although it's still funny, in my opinion. When I was thinking of what this episode was going to be, the first idea I had was that one of them would get a panic attack and then would transfer it to the other one, basically. That it would start in one of them and then it would be transmitted into the other. And that was sort of the basis of where I got started with this episode, and then it kind of grew out from there. I like the way this episode looks. I guess, you know, I don't know, I like the way they all look, but this is one I'm particularly proud of. I was seeing when I was thinking about shooting the show, the two main ideas I had in mind of how I wanted it to look, although I didn't base any individual shots off of anything from any of these movies, but the movies that I had in mind were The Exorcist and The Godfathers Part 1 and 2, which is that feels pretentious to say out loud, but I don't know, you gotta base the look of your movie on something, and you might as well choose good movies to base it on, even if that is maybe a little silly in the case of a web series. I really like Kate in the scene. I don't know, it's really funny. I like that. Thinking of the visual stuff in this series, makes you think of that in a lot of the shots where you see both Kates at once. In general, I would try and do them in a way where one of them was closer to the camera than the other, so they weren't just both equal distance from the camera, and then you could tell that, you know, it's like screens cut down the middle and one's on one side and one's on the other. One thing to kind of try and sell the reality of it a little bit more is to put them so that one's in the foreground and one's in the background, or that they're just like slightly different distances from the camera. So it kind of, it makes it a little bit more natural and maybe isn't as stilted as just having them, you know, be sort of playing one on one side, one on the other. Although there are times when I mix those shots in as well, but hopefully for okay effect. That is actually my phone. It finally died. I had it for about 10 years. And so if you wanted to call my mom, that's how you would do it. You'd scroll on that exact phone. No more. It finally died. I had it from the years 2004 to 2014, I think. I don't know. I hope it didn't give me brain cancer for being so old. That's Kate's stuffed animal, Sheltie, that she let us borrow for the show, which I appreciated. Let's see. Coming up, we've got this great Memory Boys song. I feel bad. I feel like I want to point out all the music that's been in the show up through now, but I feel like as soon as these episodes are so short that I feel like as soon as I get one thought all the way out, like half the episode has ended. But so I hope people know that I appreciate them for helping out on the show. Yeah, this is the first episode in the series that only has the Kates in it, where there's nobody else, no other actor. It's just Kate doing the whole thing, which then comes back in episode 6 is like that as well. Oh yeah, the William Temple House is a place in Portland that's great. They do a lot of stuff, including mental health services for low-income people. You should check them out. So now this is kind of the beginning of the end for the show. For the first 4 episodes are each kind of more standalone, or kind of each exist on their own. And then starting with this episode, for the end of the series now, it's kind of all one story, yeah. Or one episode leads into the next a little more strongly. I guess you could argue that that starts with episode 4, since they reference this meeting in that episode. So in a way, that's kind of the beginning. But anyway, you could look at it either way. It's not that important, I guess. This guy is Brian Allard. Brian and I made a movie called Arctic Sounds together, which I referenced earlier. So he was one of the stars of that with Laura. And so it was good to get to work with Brian again on this. So on the Zoom in, you might see at the very end that there is somebody across the street there in the car, and that's Sophie wearing a sweatshirt. And she might have had that scarf on, actually. Anyway, I don't know. It goes by pretty fast, so you might think it's Kate. Oh, this shot. This is good. You can see on the shot of Kate from the side here, and this, you can see that there's no rain on the passenger window. But if you see the back window that's behind her, you just see a piece of it, or you see the windshield. There's rainwater on both of those. It was actually raining right now, but to make it match with the shot where we're zooming out from the outside of the car, where it's not raining. I had to rig up this towel on top of the car to block the rain off of the side window so you didn't notice. And anyway, I was proud of that at the time. This episode was pretty challenging to shoot with all the different locations and things. And we were shooting it in the fall in Portland, so it was very hard to predict whether or not it would be raining from one setup to the next. I guess it was actually winter, now that I think about it, for a lot of the shoot. This episode, I feel like it was multiple months apart from the first, whatever the first thing was that we shot for this, for the very last thing. It was at least 2 or 3 months apart, just spread out, just because of scheduling issues. And so that was challenging to make it work, because just weather was hard to deal with, and also just the changing climate. It was hard to make it all seem like, you know, one day or one week in the case of the later stuff. But yeah, we ended up making it work. Kate had to keep her hair the same length for quite a while filming this episode. I like this scene. I like Brian and Kate in it. I think they're great. I like that again, the Brian is not particularly playing a villain in this, that you know, he doesn't really care about this random person whose art he's looking at, but he's not out to destroy her by any means. He's just you know, he's just doing his job, and maybe he does, you know, maybe he has meetings like this all the time, and it just happens to be devastating for her. I feel like that's something in my life, maybe, where there's these things that seem very important to me, but then if I look at it from a global standpoint, it's not really bothering anybody else. Oh, this scene was scary to me to start shooting. So that the water on the windows there. So again, so it was raining very lightly this day when we're shooting. So that's real mist or whatever on those windows. We didn't put that there. That's nature put that there. But to shoot a scene like this, you know, you got to cover from all these different angles, and Kate's got to change. So we shoot the one Kate, and then we shoot the other Kate, and then we shoot Laura. So we got to it takes this long span of time to get all the angles in the car here. And so we're starting in the morning, and I know when we start shooting, we're going into the afternoon. So I was terrified the whole day because I just felt like the sun is going to come out at some point and it's going to burn off all of the water on the car. And then so we're going to try and turn to shoot in one of the directions, and we just won't be able to recreate it. It looks too fake. Like suddenly we're going to cut to one shot and the rain is going to be all gone off the window or whatever. And so I was having a mini meltdown about it, because when we were starting to shoot, it was just, I don't know, I wanted to call it and just say to come back another day. But actually, Kate and Laura pitched me on just starting it. And if we had to give up, then we would give up. But they were both pretty adamant they were very encouraging to just start it. So we did start it, and we got very lucky that it stayed sort of the same level of misty raining the whole day. That the consistency was what I was afraid of. I love it now. I feel like it's great. I'm so glad that we got this with this great weather and stuff. I feel like it really adds something to the scene that they're all sort of trapped in this car together, and it's all raining outside. And to see that sort of real rain is kind of weird on film or on video in this case. I guess it's not something that people typically do because it's so unpredictable, but we just got very lucky again that it did end up working out. Oh, this shot was tricky. So then one Kate slams the door and the other Kate catches it. We did that one a few times so Kate would come in, slam the door, and then she would quickly change and then go back outside and then do it again. And then I combined the two things in editing. But that was one of those things again, like we had to do it quickly because, it's cloudy in that shot. And if we wait too long, the clouds are going to move and, you can't cut between them because, it'll look like suddenly the sun will come out. It'll get way brighter when the one Kate comes to step into it. So that was a tricky shot to get right. And so in this sequence, I was trying to kind of call back a lot of visual things that had been in previous episodes, like the way that she wakes up in bed and stuff like that. Those images, and so that's like this shot's like her being shaken and waking up at the beginning of episode 4. I kind of wanted to recreate these scenes from previous episodes, but now we're just seeing them with one Kate at a time, but now they're separate, that these things that we had seen them do together, now we're seeing them do apart. And then that's the notebook that Sarah made for us, that she would draw in and then cross out the things to show frustration. It's a book of short stories by David Foster Wallace that she's reading. It's a good book. Although I do feel like I like that book. I feel like anytime I'm really like feel like, oh, I should read that book, it's usually because I'm depressed. But I'm sure it's good other times too. That just happens to be when I read it. Let's see. That's funny. So this scene coming up, I feel like when we were shooting it, the one where Kate grabs the other Kate. I felt like when we were shooting it, that it was like, it looked like a horror movie, that this is like now suddenly the show has, that the influence of The Exorcist on it has, this is, I feel like maybe this is where you can see some of that in the kind of the tone of this. There she's swapping one David Foster Wallace book for another. Oh, and that's Sophie grabbing her from the couch. This scene was scary to shoot because, it's a serious scene. It's based on real things from my real life for me. So, you want to do it a certain way. But it's also like, this show started out as a comedy, and then to sort of have this scene, knowing how serious to take it, essentially, or knowing how serious to go, where you're not just going to sort of, I feel like... doing it in such a way where it's still the same show, where it doesn't feel like, oh, now I'm suddenly watching some different movie in the middle of this other movie. I feel like making it all balance was tricky. And I guess it's a matter of taste. I mean, I'm sure it works for me. I could, I'm not, no offense taken if it doesn't work for you. So in this next shot, so in this shot's coming up, this Kate. It's gonna grab the toothbrush and toothpaste, and she'll open the door, and then we're gonna swing over and see the other Kate on the couch, And that Kate that's on the couch is actually a mannequin top wearing a hooded sweatshirt and the blanket to cover up that it doesn't have any legs to stand in for Kate. Because at this point, it's running out of people. So I had to get creative with ways to include both Kates in the shots. And those are Sophie's arms lifting Kate up and then placing her in the car. And then now with this cut here, we are now in Montana. This is a rest stop, maybe like 50 miles away from Missoula, Montana, I guess. So that's where they are right now in the story. And it's also where we actually went to go shoot this part of the movie. So now with this, they're starting the road trip. Part of the movie. If you're listening to this commentary, I guess there's a very good chance that you're one of the people who contributed to this Indiegogo campaign that we did to raise money to do this road trip portion of the series. I just want to say thank you for that. And if you're listening, even if you're not listening, thank you. I appreciate it. I'm glad we got to actually do this sort of strange finale to this show that when we conceived it was like, oh, this will be great, I can just shoot it in my apartment and we'll do it and it'll be great and it'll be over. And then that's not exactly how it turned out. So for this road trip part of the show, we the route that we drove in real life is the route that the characters take on the show. So we started in Portland and then we drove up through, well, first we drove east for a while, then drove up through Washington and then through the skinny part of Idaho, and then we ended up here in Montana where we shot this. So we got there in the evening sometime, I'd say. We left Portland in the morning, and so we're shooting it in the late afternoon sort of evening time. But we're kind of using the kind of low light that you have in the evening. We're using that to replicate what it would be in the morning. So that's the idea with this scene, is that it takes place sometime in the morning, although it's kind of vague about it. Although the sun is still out when they get to South Dakota. So doing the math on it, they must be up pretty early right now. And so we're using the kind of late afternoon to fill in for the early-ish morning. And then the sound kind of does the rest of the work, like having the sounds of the birds or the highway, things to make it sound a little bit more quiet or a little bit more empty. That does hopefully kind of sell that part of the reality. Yeah, I was thinking, it's funny, this episode was by far the most difficult from a post-production standpoint, like editing and doing the sound. Just because it's the longest episode, or maybe... Yeah, I think it's the longest episode. It's up there anyway. And so just the volume of things. Also, because we shot all of this footage, because we shot driving all the way there, but then finding the right pieces or using the pieces that sort of told the story the best was a challenge, because there was just more options. Like, for example, I made the decision, even though we shot all this great footage driving between the places, in general, you don't see very much of it. Because I figured at this point the characters aren't really looking out and marveling at the amazing scenery of where they are. They're kind of more internal at this point. And so we as the audience should necessarily be seeing all of these shots of great landscapes and things like that, even though we had sort of filmed some things like that shooting from the car. It just made sense to save all of that stuff for episode 7 when they're sort of in a more upbeat mood and looking around more. And so I decided to just stay focused on the characters during the drives. And so there was a lot of work put into that, of sort of making montages and then cutting them way back. This thing that you're watching right now with these jump cuts on the Kate in the backseat, that part was sort of planned. That was one of the only sort of things that I kept in it, was this idea of seeing the time that they're driving just by, just having one shot on the one Kate in the back and seeing it sort of essentially jump cut from Western Montana to South Dakota. And so now we're in South Dakota and we're actually filming it in the parking lot of a motel in South Dakota. So we're actually there And we've just driven there now from Billings in real life. We stopped and we did Montana in a couple days. We didn't do it all at once like the characters in the show. Oh, and here actually you see one of those flags there is the South Dakota flag. That was just happened to be there when we were shooting. So part of when I think of this being a difficult episode from a post-production standpoint, part of that is all the sound work. So in general on the show, and this is true for a lot of shows in general on TV and things like that, when you hear the actors talking, that's audio we recorded right then on the day while the camera was rolling. But any other sound is put in there by me later. So a good example is this shot here where Kate is walking from the car to the motel room. This sound that you're hearing, we did not record that in South Dakota. We just filmed it without sound. And then every sound that you hear was put in there by me individually later. So like her footsteps on the ground, cars going by on the highway, kids playing in the pool, the truck that passes by, all of those are individual sound elements that I either got from a sound effects library or in some cases recorded myself and then stitched them all together to make sort of this montage effect, like all the sounds add together to create this sort of wash of a background that hopefully the feeling of it is just that you assume that, oh, we must have just had a microphone with us when we were filming, but in reality, no, it's completely silent. And every element of that is put in there after the fact and mixed to make it sound hopefully kind of natural. But anyway, so things like that would take a long time, and it's a weird thing to spend a lot of time on because, you know, if you do it well, the best case scenario, nobody notices. So now when we filmed this, this part where they're inside the motel, we actually filmed this in Portland. So this is a motel in Southeast Portland. And so the exterior, we're in the real location. And then just for time and, cause it made sense once you're inside the motel, we shot that closer to home. So we shot the whole road trip, getting all the exteriors and all those things. And then when we got back to Portland, like the weekend after or two weeks after, we shot the inside of the motel in Portland, and I had to do some negotiating to get a room that would match the exterior that we shot. So like the window on the one side and the door on the other side, it took some finagling to get it, but fortunately was able to get lucky with one of the motels in Portland for that. I think I essentially convinced this person that I had kind of an obsessive compulsive thing and needed to sleep in a room that had a window on the one side and a door on the other. That was the conclusion that they jumped to when I was asking about it. And I just went with it because it worked out pretty well for us. But yeah, so now we're in Portland. I like Kate a lot in this scene. I feel like she does a really good job. It's one of those scenes that's difficult because we have these sort of camera tricks that come up, like this pan here. And when they're sitting on the bed, there's these like visual effects things that we have to do that would sort of slow things down, or that, you know, you have to do these things. And so it's interesting having these kind of technical things to be worrying about, while at the same time needing to do this really emotional scene and playing it really honestly. And so, and it's one of those things that's, it's very tricky to get right. So I feel like, you know, I really respect the job that Kate does in the scene, because she's able to be in the moment and play it as real while these sort of difficult things are going on around it. And so, and then for my part, you know, try to keep it moving at a certain pace, try not to bog anything down with the effects, because you want to sort of stay in the moment and have the scene play out real, which is sort of one of those things that I don't know, it's you know, typically, you know, there's two actors in a scene talking to each other, but in this there's just Kate, and in this case she's acting against Regina, is playing the off-screen in the motel, so that helped a lot, having a real person for her to interact with. I feel like that helps sell the reality, but at the same time, you know, there's a lot of it that's just on Kate's shoulders to kind of find the emotion of it and be real in these moments that where there's a lot of artificial stuff going on. So I really feel like it comes out well in that scene, and it's one of my favorites in the series. Seems pretty good too. Thinking of the sound some more, one thing I would try to do in this motel scenes, because it was just quiet, we're actually shooting it mostly at night, even though it's supposed to be during the day, but a lot of it we're filming at night where it's pretty quiet. And one thing I would try to do in post-production to tie it into the outside stuff would be to put in a lot of sounds of the activity that's happening outside these doors, that life is really going on outside these walls while they, you know, they're stuck in this room, but outside all the stuff is still happening, and that's maybe what they're running away from, or there's the scary outdoor world. And so I would use a lot of sounds that I set up in that, and when she's walking to the motel and you hear all the things, like the kids playing in the pool or the cars going by on the highway and things like that. And so I would put those in throughout while they're inside the motel to give you a sort of a sense of feeling that they're still there, because I didn't want to cut to a shot outside. I wanted to stay inside with the Kates and experience it with them. But you still want to give a feel for the outside world. So try and put in those sound effects when it was appropriate. One thing I did to try and be smart when we were shooting was I brought my own blanket with us to the motel and put it over the bed, so that anytime we needed a shot looking down at the bed, I could film it back at my apartment, so we wouldn't have to get all of those shots at the motel, that we could get those little insert shots looking down at home later, so that we could focus on just getting all the stuff that was important to get in the motel, and save any kind of little insert of the book or the coin landing on the bed or the computer on the bed and those things. We had to save those for later, just to make sure that we got enough time in the motel to do all the stuff that we needed before we had to check out. So that was my little cleverness there. Now we're back in South Dakota there. We're back at the real location for that. Which I was thinking, my advice for anybody who is thinking about filming in a place where they don't have permission to film is, you know, plan out is what I would do anyway. If I were to do that, would be to plan out my shots ahead of time and know exactly what you want, and then shoot them in order of conspicuousness. So I would shoot the scenes. It's like, oh, maybe I'm holding the camera and maybe it just looks like I'm taking a photo of my friend. You kind of do those shots first. And then as it gets more complicated and you're setting up a tripod, say in that case, and you know, you kind of put them in order so that the very last shot you do is the most conspicuous, is the one. So in that case, that last shot of them driving away, where we're setting up the camera in front of the building and stuff like that, where everyone can see it, you do that shot last. So if they kick you out, at least you got everything you needed. I like the idea of starting this episode out, and maybe if you're watching, you don't really know where we are right now. If you look closely on that refrigerator, you might see the cutout says Laura on it, and then there's the little Sheltie card. And but part of the idea was I like the idea of coming off the last episode where it ended, and I feel like it would be very easy to predict where they're going, because you know they're going to Mount Rushmore, or maybe you don't know, but maybe you'd guess that that'd be the most likely place. So I like the idea of starting it here with Laura, just because it's not what I would necessarily expect watching it, and because also I knew that I wanted to end it with just the Kates, and I didn't want to end the series without checking in with Laura one last time and getting a sense of what she's up to, and maybe how her life is when Kate's not around, and what's in store for her in the future maybe. This will be shot at the actual Mount Rushmore, as you might have guessed. that was pretty fun. That was actually not too bad shooting there, because just got a tiny camera, so you know, nothing looks strange about it. It just looks like I'm making a video of my friend. visiting Mount Rushmore.
Okay, cool. I'll be back.
Which is true on some level. This montage, I guess, was the original concept for this episode. Was I like the idea of having this voiceover, essentially, of the phone message while we got to sort of see what the Cates were up to on this trip. And so this we all filmed in the real locations. This is a nice dinosaur park that's kind of silly in Rapid City, South Dakota. So we went there first, and then this is the drive from South Dakota into Wyoming. And originally, I don't know, I was thinking maybe I would put little like titles on the screen, because in other episodes there, you know, would be titles to say where they are, say some little bit of fun information or something. But with the voiceover plus the images, the addition of the text was just too busy. It was sort of, it was one extra piece of information too many. And it was sort of better to just experience it as this kind of impressionistic thing, or maybe I'm sure I'm using that wrong, but to just sort of experience it, just seeing it and by hearing her talk about it, that seeing the text on the screen saying where they are was kind of one thing too many. It kind of complicated things a little bit. But so we shot this actually on the road. There's some cows there, some Wyoming cows. Now here we're in a rest stop in Wyoming, as I guess you can read there. And then in this next scene, we're visiting. This is the world's second largest jackalope statue in Douglas, Wyoming. The first largest is on the other side of town, but the second largest is funnier to me. So that's why we filmed it that one instead. That was the main impetus for me to want to have some title cards in the sequence, was because I just wanted the title card that said world's second largest jackalope statue, Douglas, Wyoming. But yeah, it was a little bit too much. In that last shot, you could see there was a little magnet there that said Laura on it. We bought that at the gift shop at Mount Rushmore. And we're driving through the Grand Tetons now and into Yellowstone National Park, where we filmed this next scene. That was fun, but challenging. There were a lot of mosquitoes, and I did not come out too well at the end of this shoot. It was pretty rough. This scene, the inspiration for it came because when we were planning this part of the movie and thinking about it. And so I looked up, Yellowstone has a website, and I was reading, you can read this pamphlet that it's the Yellowstone Trip Planner 2014 as quoted. That's not what she's actually reading in the car there, but the text is actually all quoted from a real thing that you could go read on the Yellowstone website. If you're thinking of planning a trip there, it lays out all the things that you should be aware of and all the safety precautions and things like that. And so, and as I was reading it, I kind of was having the reaction that the Cates were having of like, oh, this will be fun. And then it just kind of goes on and on. And if you're the type of person who likes to worry about things, then there's a lot to be worried about when you're reading that.
Bear safety.
Oh, this next shot, if you turn the brightness up on your TV a lot, there's a deer on the right-hand corner screen right there. Before we get to the Idaho sign, there's a little deer on by the side of the road that, most monitors and things, you can't really see it, but it's there in the corner. And here we're in the Winco in downtown Boise, Idaho, which is a place I visited quite a bit as a teenager. Not for any reason in particular. It's just open 24 hours. And I feel like growing up in Boise, Idaho, you remember the things that are open 24 hours that you can, you know, in case you want to go buy some Swedish fish at 3 a.m. on a Saturday. It's the place to go in Boise. And it was funny to me when we were thinking about it, that the show, you know, we ended up going all over the country, that they started their home in Portland, and they're driving through all these different states and stuff, and so it's going all over. And then where the scene, where the series, the whole thing, where it ends, is in the parking lot of a Winco in Boise, Idaho, which is I don't know, one of those things that's funny to me. This part that we're seeing right now, the scene that where it's inside the car, this we actually filmed in Portland. We filmed this in the driveway of Sarah Spink, the artist who does the art that the Kates draw, or we saved the interior of that and filmed it in Portland with that, with her driveway substituting for the Winco parking lot, the edge of the parking lot. The stuff that we shot in Yellowstone was tough. We spent the night in Casper, Wyoming, and then drove into Yellowstone the next morning to shoot. And then at night, when the sun went down, we had to drive to Driggs, Idaho, in order to sort of stay on schedule with our shoot and everything. And so we only had a little bit of time in Yellowstone to shoot, just because of the drive there and the drive away and that the sun was going down. And so we had to be very fast. So you can see in a lot of these shots, like the sun is setting basically. So this is, we're actually in Yellowstone in these shots, and this is Yellowstone, and like the sun is setting because we're on a mountain or like a hill, and so we're setting the sun. And actually, one thing's funny, I'm being bitten by so many mosquitoes right now as I'm turning this camera over the valley here. There's actually a microphone on the camera. We didn't use the audio from the microphone on the camera. We, you know, dubbed in like other sounds later, or I dubbed in other sounds later with these other things. And, but the audio on the camera, which, you know, we wouldn't use for anything, but I would have it there just for, I don't know, just to as a reference basically. Anyway, and the audio on that camera, you just hear me, swearing a lot at all because I'm just being bitten by all these mosquitoes, and you hear you hear me having a pretty bad time. This shot, so Kate walks off screen, changes clothes, walks back on screen, and so this we did as one shot. It's kind of mirroring, it's similar-ish to the very first shot of the whole series where it starts with Kate, then in that long shot, she changes off screen, and then we come around and see her as the other Kate. This one, it's kind of that same idea, is that she leaves the screen, changes, and comes back. But the effect there, there's not really anything fancy that happens there, but there is a cut. So that what looks like one unbroken shot is one shot edited, where I edited out the middle part. So Kate walked off, changed her clothes, and then walked back on, but I just was able to cut out that mid part, and so it just looked like, you know, the one Kate walked the one way and the other Kate entered the going back the other. Oh, so that's the end of two Kates. That's the whole series. It's weird for me to watch it. There's a lot of personal stuff in here, but I don't know. I'm really proud of how it turned out, and all the people who worked on it did such great work. And thank you very much for watching it. And yeah, I hope you like it.